Hey guys, it's Simon and welcome back to my libgdx Kotlin tutorial series. In the last part we learned a little bit how to introduce shaders and how to make them the shield around our player ship. And now our game is actually almost finished and there is not a lot left that I can teach you. The only thing that is left would be user interface stuff, and that is the topic that we are going to cover today. So we're gonna introduce scene2d, which is one of the possibilities that you can use with libgdx to create user interfaces, and we are going to add something to our loading screen, a loading bar, also a text. We're gonna use actions to fade out and fade in the text on the loading screen, and the purpose is that we have an indicator with our asset, so what is the progress of the loading, and then once it's done we want to display a message to the player that he should click to move on to the next screen. And that is what we are going to do today. So first of all, before we're going to introduce scene2d, we are going to add a couple of extensions again from libktx to get again the Kotlin way of writing scene2d stuff for user interface things. So for that we again switch to our build gradle file of the core project, and there we're going to add a couple of things. So first of all, we're going to add KTX style. This is an extension that we need to create a skin, and the skin is a definition, let's say, of how your user interface looks like. So it contains the information, what kind of images do you want to have for buttons, for labels, for normal images, what kind of font you want to use for certain widgets and so on. So this is the style extension. Then we're going to add also the scene2d extension. This brings a couple of Kotlin extension functions for scene2d widgets and how to create the table and so on, and the stage. We're going to learn what that is in a moment. And we're gonna add one more thing, which is actors. This I'm also going to explain in a moment, but in general, when you work with scene2d, then everything that you add to your scene, like a button, image, label, is an actor, and an actor can then have, for example, certain actions. An action would be fade out something over time, fade in something over time, move something to a target location, and things like that. So that's why we are going to add those three extensions. Then we have almost everything that we need for our scene2d and user interface stuff. So let's refresh our project, and then we have those extensions available. Okay, then let's switch back to our main class. And there, I mentioned that already in the previous part, we are now going to use our user interface viewport, and we use that actually for our so-called stage. And the stage is a scene graph that is used for user interface things. You can imagine it like a tree structure. So at the top you have the root of the tree, and then below you would have the different widgets. So for example, a table. Inside your table you have a label, an image, and a text button, and those things are somehow linked together. So when you move the root, then you also move everything that is below the root. Or when you, for example, scale your table, then you scale everything that is inside the table. And the scene graph is taking care of that to make it very performant and to make every operation fast, and also to make changes on a certain group easily possible. And as mentioned, so we need a stage, which is a scene2d stage. Again, we're going to introduce that lazily. And there is one special thing that we need to do. So first of all, we need to create the stage, and we pass in our user interface viewport. And we also pass in our sprite patch. And in the end, we want to return it. So what does that do? So first of all, what would happen if we don't add the sprite patch? Then internally, the stage will just create a new sprite patch, and we would then have two sprite patches in our game. And usually you don't want to have that because that's a heavy object, and that's why you normally only want to use one. And since we already have one for our game rendering, we can reuse it, of course, also for the scene 2D rendering. So there we use the same sprite patch. And one more thing that we need to do, which is important to know, is that every application, so every GDX app, has actually an input processor. This is like the responsible class, let's say, when you press something on your keyboard or on your mouse, or when you press something on your mobile phone, then this processor is taking these events and does something with them. And we want that our processor is actually the stage, because when a button would be pressed or the user presses with the finger on a certain image or something, then we want to react on that. And in order for the stage to get notified by those events, we need to set it as the input processor. So here we simply say the stage is our input processor. So this is one important part. And this is already everything that we need. So now we have a stage, which is initially empty. We set it as an input processor so that it can react on certain things, and that's it. So this is the core object, let's say, of our user interface stuff. And one more thing that we should not forget. So the stage is also a disposable object. So when we dispose our game, we also need to dispose our stage. The next thing that we need is our skin. So as mentioned, the skin describes how our user interface looks like. So it contains the images for buttons, for labels, for images, for scrolling, panes, whatever widgets you can come up with. The skin is the core object, let's say, that defines all of that. And usually it's defined in a JSON file. And the downside of the JSON file is that it's just some text stuff and you don't get some extensions or code completion when you use something in your code. So you always need to write then the text information of the JSON file for the keys and everything. And libktx brought there an extension to that, that you can actually define your skins in Kotlin and then use them. And in order to create the skin, we first need the texture atlas again, which contains all the user interface stuff. So as also mentioned in the previous part, I usually have one texture atlas for all the game graphics, and then I have another atlas for all the user interface graphics. And what we simply do here, so I just take over the graphics that I used in the original game. So I have there also a raw folder with user interface. I add that to the texture packager in a moment that you see that, and we make a new texture atlas out of it. And then I'm going to show you how you create the font. I think that is the important part. For the graphics itself, I also show you one or two programs that I use, but in the end, I think I'm not really an artist. I'm not very good with that, so I leave that up to you to draw your different things. And yeah, that's it. So first of all, I just take over the graphics for now, so the user interface folder of the original project. You can download it from GitHub again. Then we open our project, and there we make a new pack, which we call UI. The output directory is again the graphics directory, and the file name is userinterface.atlas, and as an input, we take from our raw folder the user interface folder. Again, let's enable duplicate padding. And I think that's it. So let's pack it. Okay, so this is the user interface texture atlas. So we already have graphics now for a frame, so a transparent frame, so with no background, a frame with a dark background. We have a bar for the shield. We have a life bar for the player health. We have the font in it that we're gonna use for text rendering. And we have, for example, for a scroll pane, we would have something where you see when you scroll up and down where you are if the text would be larger and so on. So there are certain graphics in place that are used for the game, and you are free to use them as well. So I did not draw them myself. I added the credits also on GitHub so that you can see the original links to those graphics. I just downloaded them and modified them a little bit. So those are not the original graphics from the credits. They are modified by me a little bit, but only very minor changes, let's say. Okay, coming back to our code, we now need to load, of course, this user interface graphics that we want to use. And we are going to do that before the loading screen. So that's a special case because we need some certain graphics already inside of our loading screen. So before we switch to that, to show then, for example, the loading bar and the text and so on. And that's why the loading, at least the way I solved it, is happening already in our game class. And there we have this similar code that we use in the loading screen itself. So we again have asset references. And it's again a GDX array of different things. So we load a texture atlas asset. We go over all the values. Then we filter for specific ones. We're going to add that in a moment. So we're going to define, is it a skin atlas? So something that is needed to create our skin that we're also going to make in a moment. And then we map it again that we load it asynchronously. And we also need a bitmap font asset. So this one we are also going to create in a moment that we can then draw text and everything. And we want to have a flat array or a flat list again. And then we launch again our asynchronous context. And we wait until all those initial assets that we need are loaded. Once that is done, we are going to create the skin. So there we pass in our asset storage that we can then use the user interface texture atlas and also the bitmap font. And once the skin is created, we are going to switch then to our loading screen. So we move that inside here. So that's the small adjustment that we need in our game class. And now we fill in the missing gaps that we are currently missing here. So first of all, let's go to our texture atlas asset. And there we are going to define a new one, which we call user interface. It's the user interface atlas. And here we are going to say if it's a skin atlas or not. So here we're gonna pass in true for that. And here false. Maybe we need to switch it around. Let's see. So we pass in the file name. Everything else is default values. So let's put it then here maybe at the front. So here we have now is skin atlas information, which is a Boolean. And that needs to be passed in. So let's switch the parameters around. So this one is not the skin atlas and this one is a skin atlas. Okay, let me quickly check. So we stored that under the graphics folder. Okay. Good, so that's the first part. So now we have that available and we load that. Then I forgot to make the code big, sorry for that. So I'm gonna quickly scroll over the things that we have added once more. So the stage with the input processor and the asset loading where we are currently working on. So the next thing that we are going to do is that we create a bitmap font asset. So there we create a new enum class, the same way as we did it with all our other assets. So I will skip this part for the time being. So we already know that. So we have a file name, we have a certain directory. The fonts will be stored in the user interface directory that we create in a moment. And we have the descriptor as usual. And in this case, it's a so-called bitmap font. And we're going to create two fonts actually, the font 11 gradient and the font 8. When we go back to our texture atlas, those are the two fonts. So the font 8 is this one. You cannot really see it, but it's a white text here. And then we have the font 11 gradient, which is this one from which goes from white to dark blue. And the way I create the font is with the application which is called Hiero, if I pronounce it correctly. It's part of the libgdx tools. I will add the download link in the comments below. So here I have it already downloaded available, and you can then just open it. And how it works is that you, first of all, you choose one of the TrueType fonts that you have installed on your system. And then you simply can play around with some settings. So for example, you can change the size. You can add specific effects. I think when you change to the Java rendering, so for example, you can add a gradient. And this would be then the output, for example. So when you now save this file, so at the end you need to save the font file, so BM font files. And this will create those FNT files, which contains then the information. So how is your A, B, C, D and so on looking? So of every glyph, I think it's called, it describes a little bit where it can find that and so on. And then in the end, this is a graphic that is generated. It's part then of the texture atlas. And the FNT file defines where you can find certain letters. So when we want to draw the string, for example, test, then it needs to know inside that graphic, where can it find the T, E, S, and T. And the combination of the FNT file and the graphic of this font is then used to draw text on the screen. But we are not going to create fonts from scratch, so we are again using simply the fonts that are used in the original game. So we go into the user interface folder, and there you see those two font files. I can open them so that you know what it's inside. So this is how it looks like. So there you see all this information that you need to render the text. Don't ask me about the details, but I think it's interesting to see it at least once how that looks like. This would be the information for the font 8. So it links to the graphic, font 8 PNG, which is part of our atlas. And then it contains the information, I guess, of the different characters and where it can find them. Okay, so let's take over this user interface stuff again from the original game. And we stored our user interface atlas in a different folder, so we don't need that here for the time being. Good, and coming back to our bitmap font asset, we here also need a special way of loading the bitmap fonts. So there's a bitmap font loader. And the parameters that we are going to use is that we want to pass in the atlas name, because our graphics are inside an atlas and not outside somewhere. This also improves the render performance again once more, because if we don't have 2, 3, 4 different textures for the different fonts, instead we just have one because they're combined together, then it's better for the rendering performance. And yeah, here the name of our texture atlas that we have is from the user interface, and from the descriptor, the file name. So from this one here at the top, so graphics / user interface atlas, that's the name that we pass in here into the loader. Okay, and with that, we should have already solved the problems with the assets that we had here. So this part is done. Now we are missing the part with the skin creation. And the way I did it is that I created a new folder in the project. So in the normal core project, we're going to create a new package, which we call user interface. There we're going to define a new file, and this file contains the createSkin function, where we pass in the asset storage. Okay, so coming back to our dark matter screen, we can now import this method, and now we have everything that we need. So we loaded the assets for our user interface stuff, we create the skin, and then we switch to the loading screen. Okay, so the first thing that we need for our skin is definitely the atlas that we have already loaded. So from our assets, we are going to get the texture atlas from our user interface. And we definitely also need our gradient font and our normal font. And then we are going to set the default skin of our application. So there's a scene2D skin, default skin. So this is a libktx extension from what I know. And there we are going to create a new skin class. We pass in the atlas. So this is also a libktx extension. So we pass in the atlas, and now we are going to add some definitions to our skin. So this is the replacement of the JSON file that I mentioned before. We are going to define our skin with a Kotlin DSL. And for our loading screen, we simply need a label. So we are going to add a label, which needs a certain name. So let's call it maybe the default label. And now we have a label style. So usually in scene2D, you always have a widget and then a widget style. So in case of the label, it would be label and then a label style. In case of a button, it would be a button and a button style. So this is the concept in scene2D that they are using. And here in our label style, we're going to define the font that we want to use for the default font. And that would be the normal font and maybe another one, which we call, I don't know, gradient, for example. And here the font is our gradient font. So just for you that you see it, so label style, you can define the font of the label, and optional, you can define the color of the font and the background of the font if needed. And this label style sits inside the label class, which extends the scene2D widget. And this is always the same concept. So for example, when we look into the button class, there we also have the button here, and inside the button, there is a button style where you can define what is the graphic when the button is not pressed, when the button is pressed, when the mouse hovers over it, when it's focused, if it's a checkbox, when it's checked, and so on. So there you always see inside the style class, you can see what kind of things you can set for the style. And in our skin, we simply define those styles for the different widgets, and we're gonna use them then later on. So for now, we have those two labels. I think that's good enough for our loading screen. And I think for the time being, that's it. So we don't need more. Let's see that then in a moment. So that's a pretty simple starting point to define your skin. You can find additional examples then also in the original game of the GitHub project, but also in the documentations that I will link below. Okay, then we need to go to our dark matter screen, because currently we don't have access to the stage. So we also going to introduce that here. So we need access to our scene2D stage, and it's simply the stage from our game. Okay, and the last thing is our loading screen. So there now, while our assets get loaded in the background, we are going to set up the user interface. And we're also going to update then the user interface a little bit. But first of all, let's create the function here in our loading screen to set up the user interface. And what we are going to do, so from our stage, we want to add certain things. So we want to define now the widgets of our stage. So from that specific scene from the loading screen. So the method that we're going to use here is the actors extension. And then we use a so-called table. The table you can imagine a little bit like an HTML table. So it has rows and columns and everything. So every widget is placed inside a cell. So the label is part of a cell. A button would be part of a cell. And the cell can then define certain things like, for example, the distance between two cells. So the, how's they called, padding, the spacing. So those things you can then define. And the advantage of using a table is that when you resize your window with different resolutions, for example, or also different aspect ratios, then the table has some automatic layouting in place that it always looks nice and you don't need to manually adjust the position of your widgets because the table is taking care of that. So you never set a specific position of a widget. You always just place it inside the table at a specific area where you want it, and the layout algorithm of the table in the background takes care of the positioning of the widgets. So this is a, I would say, a best practice when it comes to user interface. When you have a table, you can define the defaults of your cell by calling defaults. And what we want to have in our case, so we want that all of our cells get filled on the X axis. So we call fill X. And we also want to expand them on the X axis. So what that means normally, when you add something to a table, then the cell has a minimum size and that's it. And if the widget would be bigger than that, then I think the cell sometimes gets expanded a little bit, but sometimes not, and you would simply not see the widget. And to have a little bit of a nicer experience of the table layouting, you should always call at least fill for one of the axes, so either X or Y or both. And sometimes you also need to call expand. This, for me, it's always a little bit of a trial and error because I never get on the first try what I want to have. So it's always trying it out a little bit and play around with it. So this is also, I cannot give you really here hints. It's really just try it out, look if the result is what you want, and if not, play a little bit around with the filling, expanding, and things like that. But what I learned, always call fill at least for one of the axes, because otherwise it sometimes really looks super strange, and in my opinion it's not that intuitive then in the end. Okay, in our table we want to have a label. And what do we want to display? So maybe let's call that here loading screen. The style that we use is the style that we had before. So I think we called it gradient font. Let's check once more. No, just gradient. And now, so this is an extension from libktx. So with this, we are now inside a label and we can define it a little bit. And what we want, first of all, we want to wrap our label. So if it gets too long, we want to wrap the text. Then we want to align our text, so it should be in the center. And that's it. So then we are done for the first row. So let's make a break. Then we want to have our touch to begin text. So when the assets are loaded, we want to have this fade out and fade in of a specific text. So it's again a label. Here we're going to use the default label style. The second one is the style, the first one is the text. So let's call that touch to begin. And again, we want to wrap it. We want to align it. And we want to make it transparent at the beginning. So the alpha value is 0. Because during the loading of our assets, we don't want to show that. We only want to show that once all the assets are done and the player can continue to the game screen. And the last thing that we're going to introduce is our loading bar. And the loading bar actually is a stack, so it's a combination of multiple widgets. And we also want to modify the cell of the stack a little bit. So you can do that in all of these extension functions. So also here, I could write cell, and then you have access to the cell and can, for example, say, as I mentioned before, you can define the padding, you can define the spacing, and other things that you could do with the cell of that label. But here we don't need it at the moment. Let's see, we just use it here for the loading bar. So the loading bar is an image. There we need the key from our atlas, so that should be live bar if I remember correctly. Let's quickly check. So in the raw folder, we have the live bar, so live underscore bar. So this is the key for this image. And at the beginning, so since there are no assets loaded at the beginning, we're gonna scale it on the x-axis to 0. Then we don't see this progress bar at all. And the second widget of the stack is again a label. The text is loading. Gonna use the default font again. Here we do not wrap it in this case, we just say that it should be aligned in the center. And for the cell, we're going to define a padding to the left. So for example, I don't know, 5 pixels. Yeah, let's say 5 pixels on the left side and also 5 pixels on the right side for the padding. Okay, and what we forgot, so here we also need to make that into a row so that we don't have 2 widgets in one row. We want to have only 1 widget per row. Then we want that our table is filling the parent. So in this case, it would be the stage itself. So the entire table should expand over the entire scene. So in the entire screen, actually, in the end. And there's also a method which is called pack. Here also, from what I understood, it's validating then and calculating the layout of the table. So at the end, whenever you are done with setting up your table, like we are here, so at the end, always just call pack, because then it's calculating the correct positions and sizes of the widgets, and then the layout should look better or correct. Sometimes you can leave that out and it looks the same, but I think, again, as a back practice, always call that, then you are on the safe side. Okay, so when we enter the loading screen now, we set up our user interface, so that's good. There we defined now the table with labels and some images. And another thing that we want to do, when we leave the loading screen, then we want to clear our stage. So there's a clear method. So we don't want to have the loading screen user interface in other screens, so for example our game screen. So that's why we are going to clear it, to remove all the widgets that we have defined for the loading screen and start then with an empty stage, let's say, in the next screen. So here we would move from the loading to the game screen, and then in the game screen we should get rid of the widgets that we have defined here and maybe create new ones that we want to have in the game screen. Okay, and since we want to do something with our progress bar and also with the touch to begin text, we need to save them. So the progress bar is an image, and the touch to begin label is a label. And we are going to assign them now. So touch to begin is this one here. So touch to begin label is that one. And the progress bar is that one. Just for you that you know it, so there would be actually a progress bar widget, but I always struggle to get the good result with it. So it has a, in the skin, in the progress, how's it called? Is it really called progress bar? Or is it loading bar? No, it's progress bar. And this one also has, of course, a progress bar style. And there you need to define a knob, knob before, knob after. And for whatever reason, when I always play around a little bit with the backgrounds and everything, it never looked the way I would expect it. So for me, it's again a widget which is not really intuitive. So nowadays I don't use it anymore. But just that you heard of it, so maybe for you, for your purpose it works well, then you can use it and you don't need to define then your own loading bar. But for us it's very simple, so it's actually just one image that we are going to scale, so we are not going to use the progress bar in our example. Okay, and then the only thing that we need to do now is to define a render method. So this is now a little bit special. So first of all, what we are going to do from our progress bar, the scale X, is the progress of our asset loading. So there is in our asset storage, there's a progress indicator, and there we get the percent value, which is a value between 0 and 1. And that's the indicator, so how we scale our progress bar. So the beginning, the scale is 0, so we don't see it, and then slowly it will move to the right with the scaling of the progress. And of course, we also want to render our stage. So with our stage, we need to do a couple of things. First of all, we apply the viewport of the stage, so the fit viewport that we gave it before in the constructor. Then we are going to call act, and then we are going to call draw. So act is, as I mentioned before, when we would add certain actions to a widget. Which we do in a moment with our touch to begin text, then the act is calculating the action, what needs to be done, and applies the changes to the widget itself. So this is moving, scaling, changing the color, whatever you can imagine. This will be part of the act call. And the draw call is then simply rendering all the widgets that we have added to our stage. All the actors. Actors is the correct term for it. Okay, and one more thing. So in our render method, so when the loading is done and the screen gets touched and our game contains the game screen, so everything was initialized correctly, then we do those things here below. So we set the screen, we remove the loading screen, and we dispose it. So this logic gets moved now to that place. So what that does, so now the assets are loading, then soon we see then the text that everything is done, and now the player needs to touch the screen or with the mouse click into the screen. And if the asset loading is done and also the screen initialization is done, so this is this part here and this part here, then we're going to switch to our game screen. Okay, and the last thing is now, so when the assets are loaded in our touch to begin label, we want to add now an action. The action that we are going to use is the forever action, so it should do that forever and never stop. This is again a KTX extension that you can write this plus equal. Then we have a sequence action, so we run certain actions in a sequence. Let's make a static import of all of that so that it gets a little bit shorter. And first of all, we fade in our text. So there's a fade in action. And let's say this should take I don't know, half a second, for example. Again, static import. And after that, we fade out also over half a second, for example. So what this does, so again, it adds an action to our label. It's a forever action, so it runs until the action gets removed or the widget gets removed. And we run two things in a sequence. So first of all, we fade in our text over half a second, and then we fade it out again over half a second. Then fade in, fade out, fade in, fade out. So there's an endless loop. Okay, so in theory, that should be it. Let's try it out if we already see something. And we do. So we have our loading screen label, as you see, because we used a very huge font. We don't get it inside one line, so that's it gets wrapped to the next line. We can see the wrapping when I would add a space here in between. Let's also do that. Then we have our touch to begin label, which is fading out and fading in. And here we have our progress bar. So we have the live bar. Of course, we don't see the effect at the moment because it's super fast with the loading of the assets. Let's add some debug stuff there that we can see how it would really look if we would have a lot of assets and it takes more time. And in our loading bar, we have the loading text. And currently, our entire table and scene are centered in the middle, which is also maybe not nice. So maybe you want to have this here at the top, this one in the middle, and this one at the bottom. And there you need to play around, as I mentioned before, with this filling, expanding, and all those different things. Okay, but it's working already. And now when we touch it, we move then to the game screen. So that's actually the effect that we wanted to have. Good, good. So about the wrappings, let's try that out. So let's make a space between loading and screen. Now the screen should actually be in the next line. Yes, so as you see here, so what the wrapping is doing, when one word does not have enough space within a line, then it gets wrapped into the next line. So this is also working. Perfect, perfect. And one last thing that is also, in my opinion, very important when you want to debug your scene a little bit and why things are located where and so on to understand it a little bit better. There is a debug method, so stage debug all, I think we can use here. And when we set that to true, we will get some debug lines in our screen. So here you see now, let's make it big. So if I remember correctly, the green lines is the bounding area of the widget itself. So in this case of the label, here of the image and the label, and the blue area, I think, is the bounding area of the cell itself. So for our stack below, the cell, since it's expanded on the x-axis and also filled on the x-axis, it's actually this size here. It would be a little bit bigger, but since we said that there should be a padding of 5 pixels to the left and 5 pixels to the right, the content itself of the cell gets a little bit shrinked. So that's why we see that here. So these are the blue lines. So the blue lines would be the cell, and the green line is the stuff of our widget. And with those debug things, you have that everywhere available. I think in the table, on the label, everywhere you can call this set debug stuff. There you get some kind of information why things are located where. So this is sometimes very useful to debug the scene. So one last thing that we are going to improve now is this part here. So as you see, currently we need to enter a string all the time, and we need to remember what kind of names we gave the different styles. And this is of course not what we want, because most of the time you are not working on one day on your entire user interface, and you will forget these names and you always have to look them up, which is a little bit annoying in my opinion. And the way I solved it is, again, can you imagine it? with enums. And the way I do it is that I define, for example, an enum class, label styles. And there I have, for example, default and gradient. And then instead of defining it here, so label with default, we write here then label styles, default name, and here it would be label styles gradient name. So now we don't have these strings anymore in our code base. Let's switch to the loading screen. And now when we want to apply a certain style, so for labels, we have our label styles. And there we have, for example, the gradient style. And here we have our default style. And I think actually default is the default behavior. So I think we could leave that out. Let's try that. And we should still see the text as we saw it before. So I think if you don't specify a specific style, then default is applied as the normal style. Ah, but sorry, I think it's default in small letters. And we have here capital letters, I think, for the name. So let's leave it here to have it explicit. And let's try it out. It crashes. Why? Ah, because here, okay, I get it. Here we also forgot to replace it, so we don't have default now in small letters anymore. So we need to define label styles, default name here as well. So now it should be good. Okay, perfect. Good. I think this is everything that you need to know about Scene2D skins and defining the user interfaces. As mentioned, you get the example, for example, how I created the menu screen or the HUD for the game and so on. You can look that up on the GitHub page. But the theory is always the same. So you always have the stage. I usually clear it when I switch to another screen, and then I add a table with certain widgets to my scene, and then with the event handling, for example, that we learned, I update then the different widgets. So for example, the life bar for the player, whenever we would take damage or when we pick up life and so on, I would update the scaling of the life bar and so on. So there we already know all the concepts, and you should be able to fill that out yourself. So I think that's it, what I can teach you about Scene2D. One last thing that I want to mention, so when it comes to graphics, first of all, there are certain websites where you can look for free graphics that other people share. One of them would be opengameart.org, but the website that I use most of the time nowadays is itch.io. So there you can then look for game assets, and you could filter, for example, for free assets. And there you have a huge library of things that you can then use in your game. So if you are not an artist like me, then you can use those graphics from those people. And for example, here you see this player here. That's the player that I used also for the Quilly Adventure project. Or for example, the Magic Cliff environment. This is also what I used in the Quilly Adventure. So I'm never drawing those things myself because I'm not able to do that. I just used it from those sites here. And usually I always add then credits in the game so that those people are at least mentioned. I will link them also in the comment below so you can find them. Then the next thing that I use is the sprite generator. This is actually the program that I use to modify my sprites all the time a little bit. So I load in a certain sprite, and then it has the, I would say, the main tools that you need. So you can draw pixels, and what is also very nice, you can activate a mirror mode so that you draw then the same thing on the left and the right side. So with this tool here, so it's again simple website, I do most of the adjustments for the graphics. So if I want to modify something a little bit, I usually use this tool. So you have everything in there. You can remove things. You can draw new things. You can fill it out. You have the color palette here of the original graphic and can switch between those colors, or you can define new colors. So everything that you need, I would say, is you can do with this program. It's, in my opinion, very intuitive to use and also very fast, and also for animations. So, for example, here, let's draw something again. It also gives you then a preview of how, if you would have different frames, for example, how the animation would look like. So if it's super fast or super slow, then you can see that here as well. So this is, in my opinion, also a very useful tool. And the last thing that I want to show you is the 9 patch generator. So I did not talk about that yet, but let me show you an example. So I hope I have something. So let's pick an image. So unfortunately, I don't have an example at the moment here. So this is already a so-called 9 patch. And what it does, it defines 9 different areas in your original image. So 3, 3, and 3. And you define here the area when it comes to the scaling of this image. So what kind of area will be static? So the center part here will be scaled, and the things around will not be scaled. So here, for example, just ignore the black bars at the side. I will explain that in a moment what that is. So when we define here, the center area is only the black area here of the frame. Then when it comes to scaling, as you can see, the border outside always looks good. So this one never gets scaled, and the center area, the black bar or the black stuff, will be scaled. And with this technique, you can then scale your image indefinitely, let's say, without losing the quality or without pixelating it and so on. So this is the intention behind those 9 patches. And for example, if you would define it differently, so let's say here, that only the blue area outside should remain static, then the scaling would look like this. So as you see here, it's not pretty clear then in the end, and it gets a little bit blurry. So with this 9 patch approach, you can improve the scaling of your images. And in the original project and the graphics that we actually used, I already made some of these 9 patches for the live bar, for the frames and so on. And what it does, so when you save the file, then it adds 1 pixel to the top, bottom, left and right side of your image and adds then this black border. And this actually defines the area that we specified here. So the original image, for example, was defined like this. So without the black borders on the left, on the top, bottom, right and left side. And when I save the frame as a 9 patch, then it adds the black area exactly with the area that we define here in this 9 patch stuff. So that's why we have these lines here. And when this 9 patch gets then loaded into libgdx, I assume it's interpreted in a special way, and then when you scale your image, then it uses this information to make the scaling then look better, as you see it here. Yeah, and with that, I would say that's it for now for this tutorial series. So there's everything that I wanted to teach you, I explained now in different parts, and we created now a game. So of course it's not 100% finished or polished, so the user interface would need to be some improvement here a little bit. We would need to add a menu screen and so on. But I think I explained all the concepts, and you should now know how you could do that yourself. And the example code for the full game is, as mentioned, on GitHub. So there you can look up the example code if you want. But all the concepts that I wanted to explain you, you know now, and you can do everything now yourself. And in the end, we made now a game with a loading screen. So we have also a user interface part now involved in there. And we have a workable game, so we can collect power-ups, they do something. We have a scrolling background, we introduce shaders for the shield, we take damage, we have a respawn system. And yeah, we did quite a lot of things, I would say. I hope you enjoyed this tutorial series. Let me know what you thought about it in the comments. And yeah, if you're interested in maybe other parts, let me also know. When I have time, I can maybe add 1, 2, 3 additional parts if needed. But that's it for the Dark Matter Kotlin LibGDX tutorial series. Thanks for watching and have a good day. Bye bye.